am honored to introduce this year's graduation speaker, Phil Spencer, Executive Vice President of Gaming at Microsoft and an early graduate of our program, back when we were the Technical Communication Department. I'm very grateful to have an alumnus who once stood in your very shoes address you today. Phil graduated from the department in 1990 and began his career with Microsoft as an intern. With a passion for gaming and an eye for human-centered design, Phil rose quickly through the company. Now, as the Executive Vice President of Gaming, Phil leads the global creative and engineering teams responsible for gaming at Microsoft, including Xbox and Minecraft. With his team and game development partners, Phil is passionate about pushing the boundaries of creativity, technical innovation, and fun across gaming genres, audiences, and devices. He's also an avid gamer himself. We are proud of alumni like Phil, who are leaders in their field and have applied their education to directly influence ways humans connect and create community through technology, which has never been more important than today. Please welcome Phil Spencer.
Thank you, Julie. And welcome to graduates, parents, families, and friends. Among many reasons, being the graduation speaker this year is particularly meaningful for me this week. This week happens to be my 30th anniversary at Microsoft. And as HCDE is just over 30 years old, it's been nice to grow up with this department. First, as the Technical Communications Department, to what is today human-centered design and engineering. Congrats to all the facility, the faculty, and staff for what you've created. I try to think about what some of you might say 30 years from now, because the time will pass so quickly and yet be filled with so much unexpected learning. I expect Haggett Hall will still be standing 30 years from now, where I spent my dorm days at UW. I'm still not sure how I feel about those concrete towers, but I do know that some of the friends I met and studied with, I'm still friends with today. Some of whom, for better or for worse, I still have daily video calls with in the hopes of shipping a game console later this year. As you look across your video call today at your fellow graduates, I expect you'll be seeing some of those same faces through your next 30 years. Because the people you go to school with, you study with, learn with, they matter. Beyond the education and the degree you're getting today, they are part of the social fabric you have woven around you and that will sustain you in the years to come. Cherish the relationships you've built here at HCDE. This is an unusual time. It's a critical time for our society. The world is hurting. Today, a man named George Floyd is being laid to rest in Houston. I want to acknowledge this moment and honor Mr. Floyd. I wish he knew how much impact he has had on the world. As we see the protests in our street against oppression, violence, and systemic racism, it is a devastating reminder to me that everyday regular life for Black communities is fraught with danger. Going to work, raising a child, taking a walk in the park, riding a bus. Racism is not a people of color problem, it's a human problem. It's not a US problem, it's a global problem. And I hope we will all make a commitment today to step up to solve it. As you contemplate your careers going forward, you may feel uncertainty or trepidation given the global situation today. But I want to recognize that in this moment of uncertainty, the world is undertaking a paradigm shift, a shift in how we think about work, about equality, about the planet, and about each other. This paradigm shift calls for fresh thinking and new talent. Key to navigating these shifts will be the knowledge and skills for creating technology innovation through a human-centered lens, skills that you've all gained as part of your HCDE education. Today, there are over 7 billion people on the planet, 4 billion connected to the internet, growing to over 5 billion connected in the next decade. With over half the world connected virtually, the social, productivity, and business norms traditionally created through word of mouth, print, broadcast, have become democratized and disaggregated. From one-way publishing to interactive online conversations, from face-to-face meetings to virtual presence, just like this graduation. The social fabric of our world is changing, accelerated by a pandemic. its inequalities laid bare by the social unrest. How will empathy between people also change if we are no longer so easily willing to shake hands or meet face to face? This is the ultimate challenge facing us, and one that you are uniquely equipped to answer. How do we design towards a more just and equal world? How do we design technology to be human-centered so that the face-to-face interactions of yesterday can be performed virtually tomorrow without bias, exclusivity, or fear? Something we talk a lot about at Xbox is the power of play to bring people together. And we anchor on the ideas of social contact theory, which is a decades-old social science hypothesis about how facilitating contact between people of different social and racial groups under the right circumstances will create more empathy between them. For gaming, this means more diversity of stories, characters, representation, reducing toxicity in our communities, and empowering players to create the environment they want to play in. I wonder how these same ideas might manifest in productivity, healthcare, education, information, communication, and other services as we move to increasingly virtual ways of working and living. My hope is that in your next 30 years, you will go out and weave a more empathetic social fabric, a more human-centered fabric in your chosen arenas. I want to leave you with a couple of words of advice from a learning I had in gaming. It's fall of 2016, and I'm playing a game on Xbox. When I play online, I often leave my party open so I can meet new members of the community. One day, I get a message from an Xbox gamer who wants to play. He's a guy in his 20s, named Andre, loves games, and asked if we could play Gears of War together. He said it was his favorite game and would love to finish the game playing cooperatively with the head of Xbox. We spent the next couple of weeks playing on and off and finally finished the game together. He was a really good Gears player. A couple of months later, Andre asked if he could come to our annual gaming show, E3. He lived in Compton, California, and E3 is in Los Angeles, so it was nearby. Of course, Andre could come to E3, someone I'd played games with for months and I can now meet face to face. He shared that he needed to be able to bring his mom with him, which I thought nothing of, and said, of course, his mom could come as well. In June of the next year, Andre comes to E3. I'm in a press meeting and the team comes to get me when he arrives at our booth. As I come out, I see an African-American man in his 20s with his mom and his brother. And I see that Andre is in a wheelchair. He's a paraplegic. I've been playing games with Andre for 9 months, never knowing he was a paraplegic. To me, he was a good Gears player who I enjoyed playing and talking with and getting to know. I spent the next 2 years continuing to play games with Andre, continuing to talk to him online about gaming, about life, about anything. He and I met up again at E3 2019, where I was able to introduce him to more of my team, and my daughters happened to be at E3 as well, so I introduced them. Later last summer, Andre's mom wrote me a note to tell me that Andre had passed due to health complications. E3 last year was the last time I'd seen him. I think about Andre a lot. I think about conversations where Andre shared how happy and empowered he was when he was online. In the real world, people saw his physical disability, his chair. In the online world, they saw his ability, his accomplishments, how he wanted to be seen. In a very down-to-earth moment, Andre shared that online was the only place he could show up as what he saw, his true self, where he controlled how he was represented, who he interacted with, and how others saw him. I think about how technology allowed a middle-aged white guy living in Seattle to end up with a friend he would have likely never known in the physical world. How technology allowed Andre to control how people perceived him, who he connected with, and enabled the entertainment he loved. How accessible technology allowed him to play like anyone else, frankly, often better. I miss playing games with Andre, but the impact he had on me stays. He was a great example of how technology can unlock opportunity for people to connect in equal and meaningful ways, and that stays with me and guides me in my job each and every day. As I think about your opportunity, I see the world opening up to more uses of technology for human connection through work, play, commerce, social and health services, and an almost unimaginable number of other opportunities. I see amazing opportunity for this class to have an impact on how the intersection of technology, engineering, and human potential can achieve more. Please ensure these new interactions are designed around humans, around access for all, human empathy, human learning, societal growth, and human opportunity. I know it's a big charter, but I also know it's a charter that graduates from the human-centered design and engineering department at my alma mater can tackle and achieve. There is an amazing and needing world here ready for your capability right now. I've said a lot, and the graduates are the star of this show, so I'll close. I hope there are some words here that you'll find helpful as you embark on your journey. I always like to say that I want to be defined by the things that I make rather than the things that I say. So I hope you'll show me the things you make in the years to come, and the world will be changed by them in positive ways. Thank you and congratulations.
Thank you so much, Phil, for your thoughtful words to our graduates. We really appreciate you taking the time to be here today.